Which should you choose, rock, paper, or scissors? Or in a different context, should you behave aggressively like a hawk, or should you behave passively like a dove? Or in yet another context, if you and your partner are trying to choose which restaurant to go to, and they like sushi better and you like Thai food better, which should you go to? All of these types of conflicts, and so many others, can be described using something called normal form games. And normal form games is the first major category of games that we're going to study in our journey to understand the mathematical field of game theory. We've actually already seen a normal form game, even though we didn't call that before, in the first video where I introduced some of the big ideas to game theory, and you can check out that video, the link is down in the description. But in this video, I want to see a bunch more examples and be a lot more concrete with what exactly is a normal form game. Let's start with rock, paper, scissors, because that's one that we're all familiar with and turns out indeed to be a so-called normal form game. Now, what's crucial is that first, there's a finite number of players. In the case of rock, paper, scissors, there's two players who are competing. Second, those two players both have a finite list of options that they can choose from. They can go rock, they can go paper, or they can go scissors. And finally, there's a payoff. There's a way to know who's actually going to win. If one person plays rock and the other person plays paper, for example, then the one who played paper is going to win and the one who played rock is going to lose. That is, there's sort of a defined outcome for every possible set of choices of actions of the players. Now, what's wonderful about normal form games like this is that we can express them in a very nice way with something called a payoff matrix. And this is the payoff matrix for rock, paper, scissors. What's going on here? Well, the idea is that the rows are associated to player one, who can play either rock or paper or scissors. And then the columns are all associated with player two, who can again play either rock or paper or scissors. So then if you look at one of the cells, like for example this one in the top left, well, this cell corresponds to player one playing rock and player two also playing rock. And then I've given it some number, 0, 0. What does that mean? Well, the idea is that if both players play rock, there's going to be a tie. And so neither player is going to get a point, it's just left at 0 points and 0 points. So the first number refers to the first player getting 0 points, and the second number refers to the second player getting 0 points. In contrast, for the top middle, this is when the first player plays rock and the second player is going to play paper. Well, paper beats rock, and so player one who played rock gets 0 points. Player two who played paper gets 1 point, and that's why I wrote down 0, 1. And you can go through all the other cells here, and the familiar rules of rock, paper, scissors are encoded. If it's a one, the corresponding person got a point. If it's a zero, the corresponding person didn't get a point. It either was tied or they lost. Now, rock, paper, scissors we're all familiar with, so perhaps we don't need this table to learn what the rules are, but let me show you a new game that you might not be familiar with. Hawk versus dove. Now, hawk and dove are just metaphors here. What I'm talking about is a conflict where one player is going to play more aggressively, playing more like a hawk, and the other is going to play more passively, playing like a dove. This could be something like two companies trying to decide whether to go into a new market, or two countries decide whether to go into a war, or two animals deciding whether or not to fight over some food. Now, I'm going to try to encode this scenario with that payoff matrix. So it's going to look a little bit like this. Basically, I'm imagining two players again, player one and player two. Either of them can play like a hawk or like a dove. So in the top left corner, this is when both players play aggressively. They both play like a hawk. But this is bad for both players, because if you get into a fight, the fight can be really bad for both people. So I'm going to try to encode that both players playing aggressively is bad by evaluating it as minus one for player one and minus one for player two. If they're both gonna fight, that's a bad outcome. In contrast, if I look at the scenario where player one is aggressive like a hawk and player two is passive like a dove, this is good for the aggressive one. Imagine there's some piece of food, for example, the one who's aggressive gets the food, they get 1 point, they get some value for it, but the one who's leaving, the one who's passive, they get nothing, they don't get the food, so they're just left with zero. It's better than getting in a fight where you can get injured, but you don't get anything from playing passively when the other person is playing aggressively. The same scenario is in reverse in the bottom left quadrant, where the person who's playing passively gets zero and the person who's playing aggressively gets one. And then finally, if they're both passively, like they both leave the food, they don't try to compete at all, well, They don't get into a fight, that's good, but neither of them gets the reward as well, so it's 0-0. This broad structure for a game applies in many different scenarios. You might have even heard of the silly game of chicken where two people are like driving towards each other, being like, who's the first gonna swerve? If neither swerves, they'll get into a car crash and it'll be a disaster. One swerves, but the other keeps on going straight, they win, I don't know, clout among their friends or something like this. If they both swerve, neither gets anything. This is a silly scenario, but it's a useful metaphor for a lot of interactions, at least as a base, and we can add complexity from there. Now, just because I've told you the rules of a game, just because I've encoded those rules in a payoff matrix, doesn't mean I've told you how you should play the game, or what sort of the optimal strategy is, or if there even is an optimal strategy. I'd encourage you to wrestle around with that and try to think, how would you play this particular game? But we're gonna actually have more definitive answers that help us understand and categorize these games, and we'll get a better sense of when you know that an optimal solution could exist and how you can go and find it. But it's worth thinking about, at least for now. Let me give you one other example. I call this one Sushi versus Thai. It's a classic problem. So my wife loves sushi, and I'm okay with sushi, I like sushi, but I love Thai, and my wife likes Thai, sort of okay with it. That is, we both like both, but we have a different preference. And so, if we're choosing to go to a restaurant, well, which should we choose, sushi or Thai? And we can again encode this kind of information into a matrix. The idea is that there's two players, there's player one, who's my wife, and player two, who's myself. And I've tried to put in some numbers into this payoff matrix that represent our preferences. So for example, if we both go to a sushi restaurant, we're relatively happy. Like we both are there, we're both together, we're both getting food. But my wife is more happy than I am because she prefers sushi over Thai food. So basically what I've done here is I've given 2 points to my wife, so that's, she gets the two, and I get 1 point because I'm still happy, but not quite as happy as she is. In contrast, if we go to say something like, she goes to sushi and I go to Thai, well, that's a disaster. We're not even at the same restaurant. We're not happy in that scenario. We're both getting 0 points. Like, we get some food, but we would really want to go together if we're gonna go out for dinner. So this is sort of not a good strategy for either person. Likewise, if she goes to Thai and I go to sushi, again, we're both unhappy. We're not spending the time together. But if we both go to Thai, now we get to eat together, that's good. But I get the 2 points as player two now, she only gets the 1 point as player one because I like Thai better than sushi. And again, this is just a game. I've set it up, I've encoded it with the payoff matrix. I haven't said how you should play. How should we decide whether to go to the sushi restaurant or to the Thai restaurant? How do you do those sort of determinations? And when is there or is there not an optimal solution? Again, all of this kind of analysis is coming up in future videos. My only real goal here is just to start illustrating how so many different types of interactions can be expressed in terms of these kind of normal form games. Okay, so those are a few examples, but now let's be a little bit more precise about what exactly a normal form game is. So we're going to begin with the same restriction that there's n players, a finite list of players. But now I want to be a bit more precise what I mean when I talk about a set of actions. So I'm going to say that I have a set of actions A sub I for each player. And basically each set of actions, like say the A1, is just all the possibilities for player 1. So for example in Rock, Paper, Scissors, the possibilities for player 1, so A1 is just three things, it's Rock, Paper, and Scissors. A2 is exactly the same, rock, paper, and scissors as well. Now, if you imagine an actual game of rock, paper, scissors, like one person goes rock and the other person goes paper and thus wins, if we want to talk about a specific game that's played where each person makes a choice, then I can use the following notation. Basically, I list A1 down to AN. These are lower cases, and lower cases are going to denote a specific choice of action for each player. So capital A1 refers to all the possible choices, lowercase A1 is one of those specific choices. So as an example, something like paper, comma, rock would refer to the first person going paper and the second person going rock. It's just a choice of action for every single player. And then the final component was that payoff, all those numbers that were being put into that payoff matrix. And so what is that? Well, this is a function, and I call it a payoff function, and it's got a little bit of fancy terminology here, I call it mu I, and basically what this function mu I does is It looks at any particular collection of choices where each player makes a specific choice, and it assigns to that a real number. So let me be a little bit more specific here. I'll give you an example. So I'm going to say something like mu1 of paper and rock is equal to 1. So what do I mean by this? So the fact that it's mu1 here, that's referring to the fact that I'm talking about what is the payoff for player 1. I'm then imagining the case where player 1 plays paper, player 2 is going to play rock, and because paper beats out rock, that means that the person who played paper, which is player 1, gets to win. They get the value of 1. So that's why I say this mu1 of paper and rock is equal to 1. The payoff for player 1 under this particular choices of action is 1. In contrast, well, what's the payoff for player 2 now? I now have mu2, so I'm interested in the payoff for player 2. But again, the plays are the same. Player 1 is going to play paper, player 2 is going to play rock. But now, player 2, from their perspective, they're not going to win. So they only get 0. Their payoff is 0. And that was how I built together this payoff matrix. And if I looked at any particular square, like down here where player 1 plays paper and player 2 plays rock, well, the first number is the payoff function for player 1. The second number is the payoff function for player 2. Now, I'm so proud to say that this video is sponsored by Brilliant. Now, Brilliant.org is a learning platform that has an enormous number of courses, and I originally chose to partner with them because I know that many of you have started seeing my channel through my courses. And all the courses that I have are actually here on Brilliant. There's calculus, there's differential equations, there's linear algebra, and so on. And what's wonderful about Brilliant is that it's full of opportunities to go beyond just watching a video. Namely, you get to practice, to interact, to assess yourself, and to really learn through just doing mathematics. However, there is so many more courses than just the ones that I've put up on YouTube. So for example, this past week, I've really been enjoying one called The Joy of Problem Solving, and it's just a delight. This just lets you play around with your reasoning skills, your logic skills. There's so many sort of interesting puzzles and games. One I really enjoyed with this one, which was called Humans versus Vampires. This is a collection of puzzles all based around the idea of an island with humans and vampires, some of who lie, some of who tell the truth. And you have to try to sort of do logic puzzles to try to sort out what's what. And you go through and you progress through more and more sophisticated examples. If you ever find that you've made a mistake, you can show an explanation, and then you can read exactly what was going on so that you can improve. So you can go to brilliant.org/TrevorBazet, or the link is down in the description, to sign up for free. Also, the first 200 people that go through that link will get 20% off the annual premium membership. And with that said, please do give the video a like for the YouTube algorithm. If you have any questions or thoughts about game theory, leave them down in the comments below, and we'll do some more math in the next video.